and welcome to the National Association of Sales Professionals Community Question for the Week. I am Michelle Baker. I'm the Director of Global Sales Development, and we have Rick Middlemass as our Vice President of Sales and Marketing. And if you have not joined the National Association of Sales Professionals, look in the comment section, and we have a link there for you at www.nasp.com/join. And we are currently offering a complimentary seller style assessment. Learn what your selling style is and get a feedback call. So today's question is, how do I have a better buyer conversation? This is always fun. And guess what? I get to deflect to Rick this time since I'm leading. So Rick, tell us, how do we have a better buyer conversation?
So how do we have better conversations with buyers?
Yes.
And when I'm envisioning, you know, the person asking this question, I'm thinking, you know, maybe the depth of conversation isn't there. So a lot of buyers in sales, you know, we're talking with over a long-term basis. I mean, I think of some relationships I've had in the past that, you know, over a year, there was maybe an initial large project, and then there were smaller projects that kind of came in every month or every other month. And I do remember two specifically great clients where we would even, you know, grab lunch together probably like once a month or once every other month, or a drink at the appropriate after 5 p.m. time. We did always have great conversations. And I think that was a big part of what led to the success of that relationship. Now, the other thing that comes to mind is Harvey McKay's 66 questions. And Ooh. If you have not read Harvey McKay's book, or looked into his 66 questions, highly recommend you do that right now. He's kind of like a, you know, he's been around for a while, but a bit of a legend in the sales training world. And he, I believe, initially ran a paper company where he was selling paper back in the day. And his paper company was just incredibly successful largely because he required all of his sales team to answer 66 questions about their buyers, like the salesperson in their conversation with buyers. And over a period of time, they would get the answer to all of these questions. And I mean, they were just simple questions like, do they have kids? Are they married? What are their favorite hobbies? Where do they live? Where did they grow up at? So they would end up having this whole depth of information about this person. And it just led to a much stronger relationship, much greater rapport. And you don't really think about it until someone asks you questions about maybe some of your friends or maybe even people in your family, definitely possibly buyers. You know, do they have a family? Do they have kids? What are their hobbies? What do they like to do? And you realize, I don't know, actually, but I kind of wish I asked them that question and did know. So to answer this question, I definitely recommend that's a great starting point. And the deeper that we can kind of go in our day-to-day conversations, even if it's just taking 3 or 5 minutes to, you know, obviously the most common things to talk about are the weather and the weekend, and just taking it deeper in terms of family, hobbies. Take a look at the 66 questions. There, you know, there are a lot of kind of what you would guess, but then there's a few, you know, more unique ones. And I think it comes down to just showing an interest in them, showing an interest in whether it's some aspect of them at work or aspect of them in home or personal life. But asking questions and learning more about your buyers, and that's going to lead to better conversations in the future, because you're going to be able to ask about, you know, little Steve, how's Steve's, you know, martial arts class going? He had a tournament this weekend, right? I remember you told me about that a couple of weeks ago. And those things are just going to kind of pop up. And of course, you know, the buyer is going to want to share a little bit about Steve's martial arts tournament. I mean, I'm sure it was the highlight of his weekend. So anyway, those are my thoughts on how to have better conversations, because a big part of being a sales professional is just engaging people on a consistent basis over time, building rapport, and then getting eventually to the business part in a reasonable amount of time. But so those are my thoughts, Michelle. Love to hear what goes for you.
Well, at this point, I'll just be parroting you because some of the principles of how we establish rapport and work with our clients are in line because we're both part of the National Association of Sales Professionals. But again, rapport is massively important in everything we do. And I taking time to stalk, I call it stalk to serve, is the term I use. So I look up people, and even if I already know them, I still go to, if I have access to their account, I like to go and see on social media if they've done anything recent. And it's a great way to start a conversation. You go and see that they were on vacation, or you see, like you said, they were at their kids' tournament, or they were at a major sports event, right? Oh, how was that game? Right. And people really understand. They don't, you know, it's not that you're being nosy. They know that you've taken time. And what happens is because we live in a society that's so busy, less and less people are taking the time. So that is a great way to differentiate yourself and to be a top selling and a top seller is to take the time, because that shows that you care. And again, I love the 66 questions. So I've never actually heard of that book personally. So I am going to go order it on Amazon immediately after this call and invest in something of that nature and just be ready to ask all the questions and engage them in conversation and to be confident. So I know that communication is 55% body language, 38% tonality, and 7% words. And so 93% of my conversation is at an unconscious level. So being confident that I have the ability to offer value before I even walk into that meeting with that person is the thing that I know that has always worked for me. I don't worry about selling a product. I'm more focus on being valuable. How can I, when I walk away from that interaction, how do I leave that person better off for having interacted with me? And because I understand no does not mean not never. I'm not concerned about a no. I'm more concerned about them feeling appreciated and feeling that their time was spent well.
Fantastic. Very thorough answer. Appreciate those additional
thoughts. Yeah, do you have any additional thoughts before we wrap it up?
One quick one is that this can be done during a call, meaning that I know a lot of times when I'm actually on a call, and the more people that are on the call, the better, but I will go to LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, and just search names. A lot of times someone has a name where it's super common, you can't actually find them, and a lot of people don't even have an Instagram. But there's, you know, most people who you're going to talk to will have a LinkedIn. Most people will have a Facebook, and it's usually somewhat findable. So just add that. But thank you for tuning in to our.
But before we go, we have Priscilla, Sarah. Just want to shout you out. Thank you for commenting. She said, nice one. She likes this conversation and this question. We appreciate your comment, Priscilla. Happy selling. Have a wonderful, productive day. And I'll go ahead and let Rick wrap us up. Bring it home, Rick.
Thank you, Priscilla. Thank you for joining us for this week's NASP Community Member Questions. Have a fantastic week. Don't forget to sign up for NASP in the link above and take the complimentary seller style assessment. Learn where your next level of sales growth is, and then talk to us about it.
Yes.
Have a fantastic week, and we look forward to seeing you at the same time, same place next week.